Here the first couple of days, he was awfully nice to everybody, of course, but he took us to the best Chinese restaurant in town, and we drove us all the way to Pelham, and it was terrible. I think he just wanted to show us his new house up in Pelham, or Helena.
No, I remember first year, I guess, I was fortunate to be the one of the
92-93 season.
Yeah. You know, coming down, never been down south before, coming through some back roads, I was scared to death. Stopped for gas, couldn't understand a word anybody said to me. Pull into the Civic Center, and I think Bruce Garber was the coach, and I had flip-flops, long hair, and...
Yeah, you did.
A muscle shirt, which I didn't have any muscles. He's like, is this the guy that's coming to, is this the guy? And I don't know, it was the first exhibition game. I ended up having a good scrap and got lucky and kind of one-punched the guy, and that's where it all started, I guess. That's
right. Yeah, no, it was fun, and I came down from Cincinnati, and with Jerome, we were in Cincinnati's camp, and didn't know what to expect either, because they had went from the IHL down to Birmingham, same ownership group, and put the team in Cincinnati, and so we ended up coming down to Birmingham. I mean, I don't know, is this PG or can we? It's PG, right? I can't remember. I know Jerome. I think it was Jerome. 90% Jerome was with us. It was Jerome, Rhonda, his wife, my first wife at the time. Trying to think who else is with us. Probably the first time I was ever kicked off the ice in practice. My entire pro career, we went to a country bar.
Go first.
I can't remember. I can't remember.
I remember. Yeah.
Alan Jackson was playing. First time got into country music, and you know, never really heard country music. I think Alan Jackson was coming out real big at that time and was playing there at the bar. And we ended up staying there pretty much all night, and next day at practice. Went out for practice and probably still hungover or worse.
I wasn't. I'm pretty sure I wasn't.
I remember, guys, we were doing a two-on-one drill and going in the corner after finishing the two-on-one drill to start our next rep and bumping into guys and running into guys and falling down. And he came over and he said, "Cruz, I think you need to get off the ice." So we had a lot of fun, and I was only here for 34 games, and then I got called back up, but I really enjoyed my time here in Birmingham. I think we were living at the
Ski Lodge.
Yeah. First time we were in the South, too, so I think we were swimming in November and December at the pool. And, never had that luxury before.
What was the place right beside Alpine? The little... Florida Grill.
Used to pick us up there from road trips. I remember I came down in November of 94, and I had never heard of Alabama, really, you know. And came down, and Jean-Marc Plon, Frenchie, who passed away, picked me up from the airport. And I walked out of the Birmingham airport, it was 75 degrees. I was like, this is going to be all right. But then he took me to Alpine Arena for a morning skate. Then we got in the bus, drove to Nashville, played that night. The next night, played in Knoxville, and then came back, and then they put us up in Ski Lodge apartments. So it was a tough little weekend, because Ski Lodge was not the best part of town.
I remember Ski Lodge, because first year I was down here, like I said, I was playing in Raleigh. Things weren't working out there. I asked if I could be traded. So I said, trade me someplace warm. You know. So I ended up coming to Alabama, and I called my parents, telling them I got traded down here. And my dad said, just remember one thing to say, Roll Tide everywhere you go, because it's big in that. But talk about ski lodge. I remember it was mid-February, and it was 80-something degrees, and we're hanging out by the pool. And I remember that story getting out, and Jill Bilodeau's wife said, well, next time call me. And I said, you better clear that with your husband first, because he was a monster.
I remember Bert's favorite thing to do would be to sit in his locker with no clothes on and just start chatting. I'd walk by him like, can you please put some clothes on or put a towel on? Like, look at that body.
He's
like,
confident.
He's confident.
The same banker body that I had.
Those are the days.
The one thing I love the most about playing for Phil Roberto, I remember one time he threatened us. We weren't playing well, and he threatened to take the Coors Light. We had like a Coors Light bucket of beers after we walked off a game. The Coors Light cool beer was sitting there, and you just grab one. Of course, Jerome would be drinking water. But and one time he got on us. He goes, if you guys don't start playing better, I'm going to take these beers out of the locker room. And we started shaping up and started playing better then.
I forget what year it was, Phil Roberto story. He's not all that warm and fuzzy all the time. but before we went out for practice, I put some shaving cream in his gloves. And we're all out buzzing around, and all of a sudden he comes out and he's just hollering and screaming, who in the blank put this shaving cream in my gloves? And he's like, okay, you guys, nobody tells me who it is, we're skating. And I looked around at the guys. I'm like, sorry guys, we're going down for this one, guys. This is going to the grave. We skated for about 20 minutes. I apologize to the boys after that, but
God, he was just chirping the refs for no particular reason.
Oh yeah.
He sometimes didn't really know what was going on, but he just wanted to chirp at the refs. So he'd walk up there to the board, he'd open the door, and he'd wait for the referee to come over. And the referee would come over and be like, so what's going on, Phil? And he's like, what the heck? What the heck about what, Phil? What the heck? He didn't really know what he was complaining about. He just wanted to put on the show.
Yeah.
He was great.
Yeah. I'll give Phil credit on one thing. I think it was at the very end of the year, he got our last game, season ended, and he gave a little talk. And one thing he did say that sort of stuck with me was he said it was better to be a has-been than a wannabe, you know, to play hockey. So that's really stuck with me through the years, because a lot of people don't get to make it to, you know, where we all played.
Weren't you just saying that downstairs?
I just talked to the three guys downstairs about that you know, there's only probably 500, anywhere between 500 to 600 guys between the Coast, Southern Pro, and the Federal Hockey League that are playing pro hockey outside the American League and the NHL. And, you know, you should be pretty lucky that you're one of those guys, because we get phone calls every day about guys and colleges, guys coming out, and you have to pick and choose which ones you want. Not everybody's going to get a chance to play. So it's tough for – I wish I would have been here longer. I've been around here a little bit longer. But
I got an East Coast League All-Star jersey. Because of you, Kurt. Yeah,
glad it could help. It did
have the wrong number on it, but you'll have to see what happened on that one next episode.
Yeah, next episode. Yeah, that's you can't do what I did anymore. You kind of get it's frowned upon.
Well, you couldn't do it back then, apparently.
No, and they couldn't do it back then either. But now it's really frowned upon. Yeah, kind of flipped the guy.
Yeah,
and they carried the suspension over from the IHL into the East Coast League. So,
my only All Star game ever. Thanks, man.
Glad I could help.
You guys played on the same line?
Uh-huh. Oh yeah.
Yeah,
we did. You and I for a while. It didn't turn out as good as probably you and him did.
I protected you. You went and did whatever you needed to do.
Yeah.
Bert.
No, we played good.
It was me, Jerome, and
Flanagan.
Joey Flanagan.
Joey grew from 5'7" to
6 feet.
Six feet. 6'6". Do whatever you want, Joe. Anyways, no, it was good. But now, just, you know, I guess consider the WHA guys the big bulls and we're the baby bulls, maybe? Is that what, I don't know? You know, those guys set the stage. We kind of open it back up, and pretty glad we're still here. You know, Art Clarkson, rest his soul, and like, you know, probably need to thank him for bringing these guys back. Yeah. That's for sure. I know. He helped me quite a bit through my first 4 or 5 years here. So
he helped me with my position and my bench press and my squat too. Yeah, he'd go down to the locker room before games. He's telling us how he used to do and how much weight he had. And we're like, all right, come on, get out of here. We're trying to get ready for a game. It was great.
Well, fans here in Birmingham are just fantastic. But, plenty of support from the Booster Club. You know, when I come here, you know, when they put you in an apartment, but people in the Booster Club are giving you stuff to cook with and all that, and had a ton of support, and it was very much appreciated. Back then, as a younger guy, you probably didn't show it enough, but now looking back at it, plenty of good people in the Booster Club that really helped out a lot.
I guess for me it would be hearing about these big crowds, right, and then getting here before Christmas when football is still going on. I was like, man, this is a pretty good crowd, but what's going on? It's like, no, there's Friday night football. There's, you know, Bama's not done at all. And then we had the San Diego Chicken in one time, mm-hmm. maybe after Christmas, and then we walked out there, and it was about, I don't know, 10,000 people in the stands.
I think it was more than that. It was maybe some 15 nice or 16.
Some promotions that you guys had after Christmas was awesome, and playing Birmingham in front of 10, 12,000 is nothing better. So that's what I remember from Birmingham, just awesome.
Yeah, I'd say the crowds. The crowds, that first year too, a little late at the beginning, but as they started, you know, we started coming, getting hockey back. You know, Frank Beaton, I remember Frank Beater, and good friends with him, and showed us around town all the time. And I think just the fan base was really good. You know, a lot of people from old Bulls that were here that made a living here and stayed here. You know, just taking our players in, and they were down by the locker rooms all the time. And but the fans are always the most important thing. They're the ones that that make you go. They make their organization go, and you know they knew they had. You know, coming down when I came down from Cincinnati down to Birmingham, I was the same thing. I'm like, I heard of the Birmingham Bulls like back in the WHA, but I was like, Birmingham. They have hockey in Birmingham? Okay, I think they do. Apparently, they do. And it was always, again, going down somewhere warm, too. We knew we were going. But, you know, you can tell that this was a hockey town. You could tell that the fan base was there, and even from the old Bulls was there. And it was just reviving. You know, Art did a great job of revising it. And I'm trying to think of the other two owners. Wasn't it?
Kirchhoffer and Bob Polk.
Bob Polk. That's right. So, you know, thank you for them, obviously, to bring Bulls hockey back, because now it's revived again.
I like to think, go back to the first time at the BJCC, meeting Bruce Garber there, and kind of combine that with Bob Polk. I mean, I think Bob was a wrestling promoter at some point as well. And back then, everyone had your nicknames, and, you know, Jerome stayed in my yard. Bechard came from that first exhibition game. Me getting lucky, knocking out a kid that probably never fought in his life before, and long hair, and you know, that's kind of where that nickname kind of stay out of my yard, and that's kind of where everything kind of started for me, I guess. And you know, kind of fortunate to, you know, play with some really good players and play what I like to play. You know, I said, you know, coming from the American League for the first couple of years, said I'd never play in the East Coast League because it's a beer drinking goon league. Well, I played my whole career at this level and loved every minute of it. I think that's probably the one. There's other ones, but that's probably the big one that sticks out in my mind, just because it kind of where it all started.
I'm sort of with them with the fans, and I remember coming here. I think we were playing Greensboro. We had fill it up night, at the Civic Center. And they shut all the lights off, you know, the introduction. They play the AC/DC and the lights going. And when they turned them lights on, we had just over 18,000 to take the... I think Greensboro held the record for the largest crowd. So Art wanted to outdo them. So they turned the lights on, and the place was just packed. And talk about an adrenaline rush. And, you know, the fans here were just fantastic.
I might have one more.
I'll say the hardest part about living here now is having to answer people who ask about Jerome Bechard. They're like, yeah, I used to go to a game before. And what's this guy's name? He had no teeth. He couldn't skate.
Were you here?
So, yeah, Jerome Bechard. All right, yeah. That's all everybody talks about, him or Frank Beaton.
Bert, were you here when Link Gates was in Nashville?
Yes, when you fought him. And so, I was saying a prayer for you.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that is kind of sticks in my mind, too. Yeah. I mean, you know, Link Gates taking out Jay Schiavo's teeth for absolutely no reason. Like, just little guy right in front of the net, no reason, just looks at him and cross-checks him in the face. I'm like, and really, every time he stepped on the ice, we'd all do it. Skate by the referee, hey, get this guy off the ice. He's going to hurt somebody. He's like nothing but a goon. He's, you know, whatever. And he pretty much get kicked out every game.
Yeah.
But that happened, and then I'm like, well, he got kicked out. I'm like, well, I know I got to do something next time we play him. Go to Nashville and played in Nashville. Yeah. And Nicky,
right in front of the bench.
Nicky Fatio was the coach, and he was my coach in New Haven for the first year. And now I give Link a good slash in the back of the leg, and big guy skates like a semi truck out there, and he takes a big turn. My gloves are already off. I just jumped him, and he's throwing me all over the place, up and down. I survived, and I actually got a couple licks in, and he didn't know where I was, so, and he was throwing me all over the place. But I mean, I don't know, just something that needed to be done, I guess. That's a good one, and I'm alive to talk about it too.
I saw it, and we're glad you are, too. You're bobbing like you usually do, and he was missing you, missiles left and right. We're all like, come on, Jerome, hang in there. And you did.
Then the next time he came back, it was Dan Fernell who was on the bench. And it was in Birmingham, and Phil's in the papers going back and forth. And I don't know, Link did something, or he was out on the ice, and you know, he's lined up, and so Phil grabs somebody, puts Danny Fernell, he's a pretty tough kid.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Yep.
And Danny hit him with like four of the hardest punches I've ever seen in my life, and it just kind of seemed to wake him up. And then all of a sudden, Link gets one shot, and just his nose explodes. and then Link looks back at the bench. Hey, Roberto, is that all you got? And we're all like, yeah, that's all we got. That's it.
That's all we got, Linker. That's all we got.
Now get this guy out of here. Remember playing in Lafayette, Louisiana. They always had a tough team. I mean, we were tough, but we weren't that tough. And I don't know. I can't remember. We were getting our butts handed to us down by the goal in the offensive zone, and I knew it was going to happen, but I'm like, we were losing. I'm like, what the hell?
Here we go.
Look at the goalie, and everyone else is already gone, and I just turned around and I just punched him right in his mask. And as I turn around, I see five guys coming. I'm like, it's on now. And I'm all by myself. I'm like, yeah, it's the things you did. Stupid.
Yeah, Beach, we're kind of cut out of the same cloth.
It was tough playing with Beach, because after every whistle, he would do something stupid, right? Or he'd just start a scrum. And then you know how it is when back then, anyways.
I was doing that, so I was taking all the other guys out so you could go play.
But we still have to grab on to somebody. I mean, next thing you know, you grab on to somebody, you're like, oh, no, I'm going to dance with this guy for a while until you're done your stuff. The one story we had in the 98-99 Bulls, Dennis DeRozier era, we played in New Orleans. I think it was on a Friday night, and the bus dropped us off mid-afternoon, right on Bourbon Street. And we're still wearing our Bull stuff. Next thing you know, we ended up going out all night. I think we had a curfew at midnight. And DeRozier,
how'd that work out?
Dennis DeRozier was sitting there in the lobby, and I was 5 minutes late. I was in trouble. But there's a couple other guys that showed up at 2 in the morning. that are coming here this weekend without a care in the world. Anyways, the next morning skate, it was a back skate, and we're playing that night. We don't usually do that. But we ended up winning the game, and then we drove back to Birmingham, and DeRogier had us go to the BJCC that morning, and we had to run all the stairs in the top row all the way around for hours. Dennis was not a lot of fun to play with when things weren't going well, but that was missing curfew on him was not a good idea.
But you guys won.
You won.
I would have said, hey, can we do it again?
Yeah.